please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
We've got a very special guest now joining us. Rashesh Shah is chairman and CEO of the Edelweiss Group. And he's joining us from the sidelines of the CFA Society India's third wealth management conference. Mr. Shah, thanks very much. Great to have you with us here. You know, someone half jokingly once told me that only half jokingly once told me that Edelweiss is building out to be the Goldman Sachs of India. And you know, one of the businesses which is really powering for you is the wealth management business. You know, I was reading a Credit Suisse note there talking about how. How well you're sort of scaling up that business. Talk to us a little bit about the size of the industry, the wealth management industry. How do you see that growing from here? Margins that one makes, competition. Just give us the lowdown. I mean, you're at this wealth management conference to begin with.
Yeah, I think... you know, India is growing fairly well. All parts of financial services, credit, asset management, wealth management, all of them are showing a lot of growth. But as you correctly said, one aspect that is growing fairly fast is wealth management. And a large part of that is because household wealth in India is now rapidly growing. There's a lot of household wealth out here and a lot of that is growing. And India is now becoming a capital surplus country. And as we are becoming capital surplus, it is giving us a huge amount of opportunity to invest money. And households are starting to, you know, earlier, 10, 15 years ago, most of the household savings went into gold or real estate, property, land, or into bank deposits. In the last 10, 15 years, now households are saying, can I invest it slightly more efficiently? Can I diversify my investments? Can I invest in mutual funds, equity, insurance products, alternative funds, structured products? And I think this entire trend of what we call the financialization of household savings and the entire advice and intermediation that it requires is creating a big opportunity for the wealth management products and services in this country.
Morning, sir. I completely take that point. Yes, I think demonetization really shifted the course, altered the course in a big manner in terms of how we deal with money. But the question is this, from an asset management company's point of view, what about the profitability of this business? Because the regulator has been constantly sort of cracking down and expense ratios have been falling. So over the next, let's say, 2 to 3 years, what should we expect in terms of the profitability from the wealth management and AMC business largely?
I think overall both asset management and wealth management businesses have become reasonably profitable. I think most of the companies make about 20 basis points of their assets under management as profit. And we see that as consistently because, as you correctly said, yields will come down, your fees and commissions will come down, but your cost will also get more and more efficient because as you get scale, you'll get economies of scale. Technology is driving a lot of a reduction in cost in that also. So overall, we think the margins, even if you look at globally also, I think a 20 basis point profit after tax margin on assets that you manage is easily achievable. And most of the Indian players will be around that. Some will be at slightly higher than that, some will be slightly lower than that. But what is more important is, though your yields will come down, your scale is going up very fast. This industry is growing, the AUMs are growing at 25% per annum, and that kind of a growth is going to give a lot of opportunity for people to improve their profitability and keep on investing more in technology as you go towards that. So I think the growth rate is going to be a key ingredient to watch, not just the yield into these businesses. Mm.
Mr. Shah, we have to take a break, but briefly, 20 basis points PAT as a percentage of AUM, it is, I thought private wealth management is actually a lot more profitable than mutual fund sort of profit margins. Or is it fairly similar?
No, it No, it is actually fairly similar. If you look at it, most of the players average between 10 to 15 basis point to 25, 30 basis point.
Okay.
And average for the industry is still at 20. Mm. As you know, we have grown our wealth management business fairly rapidly. We are now the top three wealth managers in India. And we look at it across the board with all the other wealth managers, and we see this trend as an average for the industry.
We're in conversation with Mr. Rashesh Shah of Edelweiss. Sir, one of your big businesses, the ARC business, is obviously where the headlines are coming from these days. The numbers that I saw, I think the book size roughly is around 43,000, 44,000 crores perhaps. I just want to understand how you're viewing this fire sale which is underway in the NCLT right now. Your thoughts on the sort of power assets. We believe, I mean, maybe 30 accounts could be pushed in unless there's some quick resolution. How would you view this, and what are the kind of haircuts that would perhaps make someone like you interested as a buyer?
As you may have seen, you know, our ARC is very active, and we have been working with a lot of banks on a lot of these power assets. And I don't think there is one industry-wide norm, but if you're seeing most of the assets are going at between 2 to 3 crores per megawatt. A lot of the power thermal assets are being acquired by people in NCLT and even outside of NCLT at about 2 to 3 crores per megawatt. But if you look at all the power assets, there are usually three categories of assets. There is one category of assets which are very hard to make them viable. These are, you know, plant based on gas or some other, you know, input which is very expensive now. So those, I think, will not find a lot of interest from a lot of players because those are theoretically unviable. The second category of assets are the ones which are viable, which are operating also, but have a lot of debt. So if you take a haircut on that, and instead of the current maybe outstanding debt, which can be 7 to 8 crores per megawatt, if you can bring it down to 2 to 3 crore per megawatt, they become very viable. Those are the ones a lot of strategic buyers, a lot of funds like ours are interested to buy. And if the pricing is right, there could be a lot of growth and revival opportunity in that. And the third category that also we have been interested in are power plants which are viable, but are currently, the project is not completed. It's 80-90% completed, and it has become an NPA. It needs some fresh money. It needs some active involvement to complete the project and bring them on stream, at which point they will be viable. So I think it's very asset-to-asset based, but there are about, I would say, 70-75% of the assets fall in the viable category, whether viable after completing the project or viable with a haircut. In that category, only about 20-25% of the projects are theoretically, technically unviable because of the high input cost also.
Mr. Shah, you have a bird's eye view on what is coming up at NCLT, what may come up at NCLT. You said Edelweiss is working with banks very closely on a variety of these assets. Could you talk to us a little bit about what should we expect in terms of haircuts for financial institutions, lenders in the second list? Maybe we'll have another list after that with a new threshold which RBI may prescribe. Should the haircuts that banks will take be similar to what we've seen so far in the from companies that have gone to the NCLT in the first list?
See, again, there is no one rule of thumb. Even in the first list, you have seen there have been steel plants that have gone at 80 cents to the outstanding, you know, amount. There have been ones which have gone at 30% of the outstanding amount. So it's very asset to asset specific. I think the general rule that RBI has that when a case is referred to NCLT, banks have to provide for 50% of the outstanding amount as the provisioning, I think that is adequate. I think on an average, across all of that, a 50% provisioning will be more than adequate for the haircuts that bank would expect to take. But individual cases might be different. There might be some cases where there might be 80% haircut, and there might be some cases where there might not be more than 10 to 20% haircut. So I think overall, RBI has been very prudent in recommending a 50% provisioning for NCLT assets. And I think that, not just for the power assets, for all the assets should be the norm.
Sir, very short on time. I'm just going to quickly squeeze in this last question. That second bucket of stress power loans that you spoke of, where, you know, buyers like you would have some interest, where there is a scope to turn things around, What kind of a haircut would be reasonable? Well, you said if the price is right, because right now the market is baking in some very strong recovery numbers for a lot of these corporate lenders, for banks like SBI, ICICI, lenders to these assets. So I just want to get the sense whether we are in touch with reality here in terms of the haircuts that buyers and sellers might agree on.
As I said, if you see a couple of power plants that have also got done, a lot of the cases are going at 2 to 3 crore a megawatt. So rather than say haircut, because if your carrying cost is say 5 crore a megawatt, then a 3 crore is only a 40% haircut. But if your carrying cost is 8 crores, then a 2 crore per megawatt is a 75% haircut. So it's very hard to give a clear percentage. As I said, average for the portfolio, a 50% haircut, which is what RBI is expecting and asking banks to provide for that, is very much a good estimate on that for the portfolio as a whole. So I don't think there'll be a root shock for the banks where what they are providing, they will be inadequate. I think what they are providing will be more than adequate to cover the actual haircuts that they will take. But we should average look at the rule of thumb of 2 to 3 crore per megawatt for these power assets.
Mr. Shah, thank you very much. Appreciate you joining in. It's a great conversation as always. Thanks for your time here today on CNBC-TV18.